Hi there. Well, on Saturday, the Ministry of Health officials became alerted to the fact that it was possible that a swine flu was evident in New Zealand after a group of young students from Rangitoto College and potentially Northcote College had arrived back in New Zealand on Air New Zealand flights from Los Angeles, but had been in Mexico studying Spanish. And the fear was that they were then showing flu symptoms and potentially had swine flu. As the case has unfolded, we now know that the Northcote College students don't have swine flu, and that of the 10 that were tested from Rangitoto College, it looks as if 3 at this stage are showing symptoms of swine flu. The government has a pandemic plan. It was put in place a number of years ago. It's a very thorough plan. You can have a great deal of confidence in that plan. It was ticked off by the WHO, the World Health Organization, as a AAA-rated plan. I think New Zealand's shown that it's some real leadership, actually, as the outbreak of swine flu has become better known and better understood. We've done everything from having health professionals at the airport, checking flights, making sure that those who show any flu symptoms, you know, are getting treatment straight away. The important thing to remember here is that if you show symptoms of the flu and you've been in Mexico or North America, you should definitely make sure you go to the doctor and go to the doctor quickly. In the case of if you do have swine flu or influenza A, then we can administer Tamiflu to you. Or if you're in isolation and there's family members around you, also the same thing. If you're interested in Tamiflu, this is the way it works. There's about 1.25 million doses of Tamiflu available currently in New Zealand. We have one of the highest ratios of Tamiflu per capita, so the highest number of doses relative to the population. So it's around about 30-odd percent. If you have influenza A or swine flu, any of those things, Tamiflu will help in the recovery process. If you take it as a precautionary measure, it works, we think, but only works actually in the time that you're actually taking it. It's a 7-day program, 2 tablets per day. So that's why we don't issue it to everyone today, because the moment you stop taking it, it wouldn't help you, and who knows what you might need in a month or 2 months down the track. So I think you can take great confidence that we're dealing with that issue seriously. And making sure that we're on top of the situation. I think Tony Ryle, the Minister of Health, has done an outstanding job, as have the health professionals. So I don't want people to be panicked about the situation, but obviously if you're showing any symptoms of flu, please present yourself to the doctor. Fastest way to break the cycle is actually washing hands. It's also spread much more easily through sneezing, but not necessarily just because you're in the room with somebody that may have influenza A. So that's the situation there. The government will keep you posted and give you updates as soon as we have information to hand. In terms of travel to Mexico, we would advise against travel for certainly discretionary or tourist activities. There is risk there. The interesting thing actually with this outbreak of swine flu is that it's now in other countries. We know it's in the United States and other parts of the world, New Zealand for instance. But in those other countries, and there's quite a few, people have had it on a very mild dose, they've been recovering quickly, and certainly no one's died. So it's only in Mexico where they've died. We're not quite sure the reason for that, but it seems like they're getting secondary complications. So again, a very different set of circumstances there. On Saturday we had ANZAC Day. I spent ANZAC Day here in Wellington with my family. Went to the dawn service, which was, I thought, a very moving occasion. A time to commemorate and to pay our respects for those who fought for New Zealand's freedom and democracy. Every year now, those dawn services and the ANZAC parades around the country are getting bigger, particularly a lot of young people coming to those parades, which is fabulous to see. It's also an opportunity to reflect on the New Zealand men and servicewomen who are around the world. We're represented in many, many countries, a big contingent of New Zealanders in Afghanistan and East Timor and in the Solomon Islands, but also dotted around other parts of the world, from Iraq right through to other parts of Europe and Asia. So a great opportunity there for us to say thank you for those who work hard to protect New Zealand and as we combat a more challenging world these days. So that was good. And at 11 o'clock I went down to the National War Memorial, to the Tomb of the Unknown Warrior, and it's a nice service there which lasted about an hour, and it was great to have Brona accompany with me, and actually as it turned out the family spent the weekend in Wellington. Number of things on the program ahead. One of the issues the government's dealing with is the Supercity in Auckland. if you actually distill the debate, what the Royal Commission said and what has had, I think, a consensus acceptance of, is that we need a better structure for regional governance in Auckland. So the Auckland Council is going to be that structure. It'll have regional-wide powers for amenities, for rating, for planning, for roading, for water. And I think that's widely accepted as the right approach. What we are working on is that second-tier local boards, you know, what responsibilities they have, what their role is, what scope they have, how they're funded. There's a number of options here. We've laid out an option for about 20 to 30 of those local boards. We think that makes sense, but you know, we're listening to the public and we're listening to the submissions that will come through the select committee process. Indeed, as we're listening to the fact that at the moment we think 12 of the 20 councillors on the Auckland Council should be elected from wards and 8 at large, but there's quite a bit of debate in that area. In the end, you'll never get a unanimous support of one structure or the other, just in the same way that if we left the status quo, there's no way there would be unanimous support. But what we do know is that Auckland needs to be able to compete with Sydney, Melbourne and Brisbane. It needs to be a driver of economic growth so that New Zealand can grow. It's the home of a third of the population, and we need Auckland to be more successful. And one of the ways of achieving that is through better local governance there. So we're working our way through it. I'm confident in the end we'll come up with a process and a governance structure which is broadly endorsed by the public and which will deliver on the outcomes that we want. And that is something that's bedeviled, I think, Auckland for quite a long period of time.